We're being filmed today for the Discovery Channel in Canada, so I had to make sure the microphones were all correct. They're going to be recording for your questions later on, and I hope you will have some when this is all over. We've got quite an audio-visual taste spectacle, how else would you describe it? We're very lucky to have Sam Bompas here today from Bompas and Parr. I don't know why I'm rambling so much. We're also joined by Dave from the Gourmand magazine, and I'm Chris from Supercollider. This whole event came about because we are doing a pop-up shop downstairs. You might have seen it on the way up here. Pop Rock Moon Shop. It's been running for the past couple of weeks here at the Pop Rock the Moon. And as part of that, we asked artists, designers, makers, creatives, brewers, distillers, etc., to make stuff and contribute lunar ephemera to the exhibition. And one of the most interesting submissions we had was from Bompas and Parr. We had Parabolic Sherry, which you'll be sampling a bit later on. And it was sort of sitting on the shelf for a couple of weeks, and this is really good, everyone's asking about it. We should really do something a little bit more about this. So we kind of thought, what can we sort of put together? This was like maybe 10 days ago? Yeah. 9 days ago? What can we sort of throw together at the last minute, have a little tasting event? And we kind of, I guess, took it a little bit too far, really. So we roped in poor Dave, who does an excellent magazine called The Gourmand, which we'll be seeing in a while, and he cut together this short video just to introduce today. So with no further ado, welcome to A Brief History of Drinking Peace. As I said, Bompas and Parr probably don't need an introduction, but we'll do them one anyways. Sam, do you want to talk a little bit about what you've done in the past?
I'll steal some money.
It'll be a pleasure. Yes, okay, so at Bompas and Parr we try and give people awesome food-based experiences ranging from the scale of the glass to a much more macro scale as well. So the last project we worked on was creating flavored fireworks for Multi Central Fireworks Show for London New Year's Eve. So that was actually a few more people, that was a quarter of a million people were in front of for that. But I think this is almost even more intimidating because I've heard that there's some very knowledgeable scientists in amongst you today. And while we get excited about science, we're by no means experts. And so I hope you'll find our exploration into alcohol in space enlightening, but certainly it should be quite tasty as well and extreme. Well known for jelly and cocktails. So you might not know about the science side, but we know about the booze. That's enough of that.
Dave, do you want to introduce the Gourmand?
Sure, so I published the Gourmand, which is a food, arts, culture journal, really, that kind of celebrates food as a catalyst for creativity of all different kinds. And while Sam is an expert in booze and Chris is somewhat of an expert in space, I'm happily sitting between them as an expert in neither, but hopefully not. I've learned a lot through doing this anyway. The few days we've had, I've sort of forced myself to find out a lot, and it's an incredibly interesting subject, and I'm sure after all of the little tipples that we have planned as well, it'll be even more interesting for everybody.
Let's quickly show a few of
The shot before this is actually dishwater that was taken at a photographer that worked at Whole Foods Market. He took 1,000 photographs of dishwater. This was sort of classic cocktails broken down into their components, scientifically into the exact amounts. So this serves 5. This is a margarita. And this was looking at food that could potentially power its own destruction. So this is an octopus carpaccio making itself.
Leads nicely into super player opinion, whatsoever. We'll keep it brief because we've got a lot to taste and show you today, but basically we are super player. We do publications, books, little magazines, we do field trips, this was to Iceland, we've also been to Sweden to see the transit of Venus, and as previously mentioned, downstairs, the Pop Rock Moon Shop as part of Republic of the Moon. Selected items now on sale. With no further ado, in the short time we have, we put together a series of space drinking stories that, you know, astronauts might tell sitting around, you know, in years to come, looking back on the good old days. To kick things off, Dave, if you could hold the microphone and maybe ramble a little bit, I'm gonna get a certain song.
Sure. So the first part of this is just why you're sitting on different sides. When we started looking at booze in space, the thing that there's definite difference of opinion between the Russians and the Americans as to whether it's something that's acceptable. And generally, you can probably guess which thinks it is and which thinks it isn't. Anyway, if you sat on the American side and you're worried you're not going to get drink, it's fine. You still will get drink. Americans generally don't like drinking in space very much.
Chris, can I hand back to you and we can start into the Russian history?
Yeah,
absolutely. This is file footage of actual Russian cosmonauts celebrating Yuri tonight, which is an annual celebration of all things Russian, and specifically the fact that they were the first to put a man in orbit, followed not too long after by alcohol, as we've discovered on our limited research. This is a Russian medical kit, and in space this apparently contains, what, cognac? Is that the...?
It's cognac.
Yes. Which, it's in the medical kit, and there's some quotes that say it's very important to stimulate the immune system. And also, there's something you pulled out as well, which is, there's lots of other justifications of it. They're all sort of touching on medical, but not really.
But they're not quite. We've got some lovely quotes which says, they like to keep the whole organism in tone. And there's also, there's tons of work to do. Especially exhausting are the spacewalks, where they can lose several kilos in several hours. That's why many of us think that it wouldn't be that bad to have a little drink to replenish one's strength.
So, yeah, that was the thing. There's also actually, I think it's a slide you've got on here. Well, it's after this one, but we can... Maybe this is the appropriate one. Yeah, so this shot was on the International Space Station. It was taken by an American astronaut in a kind... He's basically grassing up the Russians for having a celebratory tip-off. And this went back to NASA, and there's lots of sort of words being had.
Yeah, we should point out, it's an interesting footnote.
It's on Is it on beer?
This is cognac, actually, this one.
Yeah. Oh, it's near space.
Yeah, space. I think it was... Was it beer? I'm not sure.
Oh, beer. I thought you said beer.
It's not a space station beer.
Yeah.
That's the one at the beginning.
I think this was on beer after they had an emergency. They had an impact. One of the spacecraft tore a leak in something, and I had to rush around and rescue it. And after that, to celebrate the fact they survived, they popped this thing open and had it floating around. You can see the interesting Russian cosmonaut fashion going on in the and the reason it's so blurry is that NASA controls this image. There's no, you can't actually find it on any of the press sites. The journalist who found it had to request the actual specific image number, and they wouldn't give them the high-res image, so it's the only one that exists. It's just from NBC News, and it's incredibly hard to find. So if you find the high-res version of this, let us all know. Let the arts catalyst know. Let us know. So it's very rare and hard to track down. We don't have to rely on photo evidence. We actually have video evidence as well. This is a cosmonaut's birthday, I believe also on the air.
This is a very impressive feat.
It's a bottle of vodka.
This is live broadcast on Ukrainian TV.
This is live broadcast on Ukrainian TV at the time, and the man obviously was a national hero.
Yeah, we should probably point out that he's Ukrainian and not Russian, so that's the flag.
There's actually an interesting aside about, you know, you might ask how the alcohol gets up on the space station. So there's a rumour that we haven't been able to substantiate that the astronauts working on the ISS at the moment, they're obviously working for a number of different research teams on the ground. And apparently the research teams, to try and bribe the astronauts to spend more time on their projects rather than anyone else's. And they do this by siphoning off weight on mission-critical equipment, instead substituting in an illicit bottle of something special. We can get up and get the astronauts to spend more time on their project rather than anyone else's.
Actually, well, you had lots of these that day.
Yes. Onwards.
So, that takes us to round two. We will come back to the Russians briefly before we depart the Cold War race. If we want to get the American round ready to go, this is obviously a little bit more religious in overtones. Before we get there, we'll quickly tell a story of actually drinking in the American space program. It goes back all the way to the beginning, even before they're going to space. And this is Chuck Yeager, just before or prior to or after, in fact, making his record-setting supersonic flight. He'd been out drinking the night before at a bar way out in the desert, and had ridden a horse home drunk. crashed into a fence post. He broke and really hurt his shoulder in a bad way. And to launch the Bell X-1, which is what this craft is, the first supersonic aircraft, he actually had to rig up a broomstick so he could reach across with his bad arm and pull this lever, which he couldn't do because of this injury, sustained while drinking. So basically, from the get-go, the American program was ridden with alcohol abuse. Which most famously, on the moon, July 1969, Buzz Aldrin, Neil Armstrong are up on the moon. Before they stepped out on the lunar surface, Sam, what happened?
So before they stepped out, at this key moment, Buzz Aldrin decided to take communion on the moon. And he writes about it quite poetically in his memoirs, saying that the wine itself, the communion wine itself, swirled like syrup in the cup because of the reduced gravity on the moon. So we have, in fact, our own simulated lunar wine here, lunar communion wine. So what we're going to do is we're going to pass it back and forth, variously across the astronauts' American side, take a napkin as well, have a drink, have a wipe, a courtesy wipe, one napkin per person as well. We're okay, thank you. One napkin per person, and pass it up. I would say that in the rush to get this done, it was very, very difficult to go to the place behind Westminster, which sells all the communion wine. So he had to make our own.
But the thickness of it.
So what we've done is we've taken communion wine, normal sort of relatively cheap wine. We've sweetened it up so it tastes a bit like communion wine. But then also we've thickened it as well, so you get a syrupy swell to simulate lunar gravity. There's also something else as well, and we just thought that adrenaline levels on the surface of another planet would be running, another moon, would be running high. So just to give that extra bit of excitement, we've put a big bump of caffeine in it too, so you can have the full drinking on the moon communion experience.
So he actually, it was a Webster Presbyterian Church, which was his church, which I think has some link with NASA in itself. And every year they have a lunar communion Sunday where they reenact the communion on Earth. And that he actually said, probably after a chat with a PR person at NASA some years later, that in hindsight he wished he'd done something slightly more inclusive for all of humanity. Because, you know, space is owned by all, not just by Christians. I also thought it was quite interesting that, you know, man on the moon, this incredible feat of science, this amazing, the amount of kind of scientists and people working on it that's got into it, the first thing done by humans is incredibly religious. It seemed like an interesting thing happening there.
Absolutely. While you all sample the wine, and make sure you swirl it around, because Sam put a lot of effort into recreating 1/6 Earth gravity for you all. We're going to enjoy an excerpt from HBO, including some awesome acting, recreating the moment where they took communion on the moon.
Thank you.
appointed a reverend. As a brief footnote to the whole story, around the time of the moon landings, there was a specific lunar cocktail going on. Is that true? Not that you were there at the time or not.
Yeah, in 1969, obviously the world went lunar crazy, so a lot of cocktail bars cashed in and produced what was actually a lot better than the wine consumed on the moon. One of them, which I think you can still have in the Savoy cocktail bar, is the Moonshot, which is cognac, champagne, and orange juice as well. If anyone likes, I've got a very good recipe for it that's suitable for outer space because it's just slightly gelled as well. You can have it in a tube so it won't get, well, won't interfere with your instruments. Actually, it won't interfere with your instruments, but not the spacecraft's instruments.
The world needs more food and drink in tubes, I think. It's one thing missing from modern society. As are these gentlemen, these hard-drinking men of Apollo 14 who went to Nordlingen in Germany to conduct research on space rocks. And this was, they were a little bit sort of proud of themselves because the first couple of missions went and just picked up anything that they could find, whereas the later missions, 14, 15, and so on, were actually very specifically trained in geology, had to recognize different rocks, different formations, in order to get the most out of their trip to the moon. And these guys clearly got the most out of their trip to Germany, as you can see. Best quote was, "We've learned a lot thus far, not only about lunar material, but also about the Bavarian beer. Man, it's great." And the whole sort of alcohol, Apollo, Russian thing kind of came to a happy ending in 1975 with the historic Apollo Soyuz test mission, which you can see here. So you've got the Soyuz on the left, obviously, my left, your right, and the Apollo, leftover Apollo hardware, which they didn't use. And what they did is they rigged them up so they could both connect in space and test docking, and here's a recreation of how it might look before it happened, and this is how it actually looked when it did happen. You got to these guys in their lovely brown 1970s era suits. And I don't know if you can make out the label, it's not the best picture, but it's a tube of borscht with Russian vodka labels humorously taped over it. It was a joke among us that the Russians would have a vodka toast in space. Do you know where they had tube with vodka written on the side? It was really a Russian soup called borscht. It really had a good sense of humor. So yeah, a happy ending to the sort of Cold War space race, which brings us nicely to part two. And again, the reason we're all here, the parabolic sherry, not just a sort of clever little pack of sherry which you can buy in the shop downstairs, but an interesting story, in fact, going all the way back to the time of Francis Drake, which is why we've called this segment Journeys on the Cosmic Sea, or Skylab and the Return of Sherry. And this is Francis Drake, explorer, pioneer,
sherry
legend, sherry.
Yeah, so sherry is actually, this is really talking about NASA's only official foray into getting alcohol in space, which came sort of in the 1970s, in the early 70s. They were starting to contemplate going for much longer journeys. And they also realized that all of the space food that they'd been giving their astronauts was absolutely diabolical. I think the guy, one of the chiefs running the program for NASA, thought, well, in aid of fairness, he would try and subsist for a few days on astronaut food. He did so for 3 days, at which point he said he lost the will to live. So at that point he thought we should probably be trying harder to give them great meals, especially because at the time they're starting to contemplate, well, what happens when we go to Mars, when we go for longer missions, and when people are up in on Skylab for 53 days, 54 days. And at this point, I thought, well, maybe a little wine has its own merits, its own qualities. They might not be nutritional, but it can act as a relaxant and something as a reward for the astronauts as they're working. And what they did is they contacted the University of California, who had the wonderful job of recommending the ultimate wine for space. And after a lot of very, very thorough research, they came full circle into the very wine that Drake pioneered and popularized, actually, in England, which is sherry. Obviously, at the time, the great thing about sherry is you could ship it all the way from Portugal, and it's been kicked around on the sea, and you could still drink it when you got it. And it's exactly the same challenge with that you've got if you're shipping it up into space. So there are very few wines that can resist in such a robust way as sherry. The vibrations and the excitement and agitation of you blast it off up to the Skylab. So sherry is very held out for that. It also had a number of other advantages as well, which we'll see ourselves as we pass out some of the parabolic sherry samplers. So I'll be coming around now.
We should say this is non-denominational, I suppose.
This is very wrong.
And not to drink it yet.
Yeah. Don't drink it yet.
I need to turn the gravity on first.
Try to do the loop thing.
That's another one of my not so interesting footnotes. I found this photo of, this painting of Sir Francis Drake, would it be?
Yeah.
Has he noted for his efforts?
Absolutely.
I'm going to share because he is, in fact, sitting in front of a globe as hundreds of years later the Skylab astronauts would be as they prepare to lift off for America's first space station. This was Skylab, which pioneered a lot of technology now being used on the ISS. A reminder not to drink your sherry yet. Please do not drink your sherry yet.
Do you know what this instrument in the back of this photo is?
I think that's just a model of Skylab, a model of the actual space station. And this is it. This is it in real. The actual space station would need to be three times as big as this. Station. Yeah, here's a real thing floating in orbit sometime before it crashed into Western Australia.
Very good. Has almost everyone got a glass? If anyone's not, could we have one as well?
Yeah.
Thank you. If anyone's not got a glass, put your hand up and we'll bring one to you shortly. Yes. Perfect. Thank you very much. Okay, so for everyone that understands taste, you need to taste stuff. Well, not with your mouth. With your mouth. Sorry. Not just with your mouth. Your whole flavour apparatus involves your nose as well. And in fact, you can you get a lot more of the aromas with your nose than you do with your mouth. Your mouth and tongue is a very base and crude instrument relative to what's going on in your nasal passage, which is one of the many reasons why sherry is possibly the ultimate space beverage. So, what these space sommeliers were really looking for, let's first sort of prepare and explore our noses, I think, is the thing to do. So if everyone could first of all smell their hand, and this is smell your hand, not the glass, sorry. And that's sort of like neutralising your smell. Now secondly, you'll need to smell something that's quite other from you. So I'd like to lean across to the person next to you and gently smell them. It's a good way to get intimate. Okay. Now we're ready for now we're quite good terms with the person next to you. This might need some coordination. Now what I want you to do is hold your nose, keep holding it, and have your first sip of the sherry. And you should be able to get something. It's quite ambrosial, the sort of drink of the gods. But while you're holding it, you don't get that much. And this is the real problem with drinking in space, is that you can't really smell very much. So you need to have a punishingly sweet beverage like this, which is very sort of, it's got an incredible nose to it, to be able to get anything at all. One of the problems, if you look at sort of pictures of astronauts, is that they tend to look a little bit bloated, it's not very glamorous. And when you're in zero G's, what happens is all the blood starts floating up. It doesn't sort of, you don't get fluid redistribution like you do in a gravity field like on Earth. And so all the blood sort of sits and floats around your face. The impact of that, all that blood in your face, is you can't smell very well.
which means that when you're drinking wine, you can't get a very good hit of nose off it. So if you have this sherry now, and you start sniffing it, and you start getting licorice, toffee, a lot of raisins on the nose, and now not holding your nose, you have a drink. And it's literally like liquid Christmas cake. It's so bloody treacly. It's almost sort of difficult to drink, I think, without having to have a really sort of stubborn meal and warmed up the palate with numerous other beverages before. Then it's got this lovely other sort of long finish, which is a coffee and chocolate and all those sorts of things as well. But I think the thing that's really interesting here is they had to like really push the alcohol content and the flavour content really right up for people to get anything with the parabolic sherry. And actually, the tale has a bit of a sad ending, actually. I find because while they
the sad ending is while
they did all this research, they're really concerned about the astronauts' well-being. And they started tasting this parabolic sherry because they tested long parabolic flight. And parabolic flight is where you go in that plane, it goes an elliptical parabolic arc to the Earth's center of gravity. So it means that in the plane you can experience weightlessness. And they wanted to test that and see what happens. Parabolic flight, the plane that takes them up, is also known as the vomit comet. And sadly, when they had the wine on the vomit comet, that mingled with the residual smell of bath after many times, apparently made that almost universally everyone was incredibly sick. At the same time as this, someone was doing a press conference and they let slip that NASA was testing wines. And because a lot of people see astronauts as these sort of very pure vessels that can do no wrong, they couldn't contaminate their body possibly with alcohol. And NASA was very, very worried that they'd get all their funding cut, so they cut the wine in space program, fired their space sommeliers. But there was a grain of happiness, which was they'd already bought lots of sherry, and all the ground crew who were going into an airlocked 53-day simulated NASA Skylab program were able to take it all with them, which made the 53-day sentence a lot more bearable.
Might be interesting for you guys to talk a little bit about, as well as the fact it's very sweet, there's certain other things that mean you can't drink certain liquids in space. Bubbles, for example.
Indeed, yeah, we might
say
that for the champagne.
Okay.
Just you wait. Okay. Keep bubbles on the mind.
Dave is desperate to tell you about liquid ropes, but that will be coming soon.
That greatest discovery show.
See the logic for the moment into liquid ropes.
Absolutely, it's all slightly unsettling and slightly queasy-inducing. Before we move on to part four, let's reckon where we are. I've had too much lunar sherry. Is the parabolic sherry on sale? Can people scramble and fly at each other to purchase it today?
Well, I think we made two bottles of it, and then another six for tasting. So it really depends how many we've drunk together. I was just going to give it away, really.
All right. Hey. Well, while you continue to drink as much parabolic sherry as you like, we're going to take a commercial break and look at basically this is what we saw. This is what's kind of been happening in the past couple of years, where basically people have realized that space tourism is coming, something's kind of happening, Branson's doing something, isn't he? Let's get on this, let's jump on the bandwagon, let's do some stuff. There's been a few things like, people have put like everything on the end of a balloon and shot it in space. Quite a few alcohol brands have done that. We thought we'd dig out some of the kind of, more and less groundbreaking examples of what people are doing commercially at the moment. Feel free to refill your glasses. I think there's more communion wine at the back if somebody, wants more. You didn't get enough.
Astronauts may be one step closer to kicking back with a cold one in space. And they may have an 11-year-old from Highlands Ranch to thank for that. He's creating a microbrewery for the International Space Station. Michael Bonetsky is here to tell us more. An Australian microbrewery has joined forces with a space engineering firm to produce the first beer for consumption in space. The partners believe space beer will become a requirement for thirsty tourists when the space tourism industry takes off, although perfecting the brew has not come without its challenges.
When the space shuttle Endeavour blasted off on its final mission, it carried with it six crew and a $2 billion particle detector for space research. One thing it wasn't carrying, however, is beer. NASA won't allow alcohol in space, and probably for good reason. But far away in Sydney, Australia, two entrepreneurs are looking ahead to a new era of space travel for tourists, whom they believe will want to sip on a beer as they orbit the Earth. Dr. Jason Held of Australian space engineering firm Sabre Astronautics and Jerron Mitchell, who owns the Four Pines Brewing Company, have already created a prototype for the first commercially available space beer. It's called Vostok Four Pines Stout.
It's going to be the first beer that will be specifically designed to be drunk in zero gravity with upcoming space tourism about to kick off.
Mitchell and his partner believe they are ahead of the curve. The Russians, who are known to enjoy the occasional drink, are already taking rich tourists into space. And British businessman Richard Branson is building the infrastructure for his own space tourism business. According to Jason Held and Jerron Mitchell, wherever man has ventured, beer has followed.
We took all the research from food and non-alcoholic beverage that we had in the past, and there was about 50 years or so of that, and we applied it to alcohol because there's never actually been any formal studies for alcohol in space because there's never been any need.
But soon, he says, there will be a need which Four Pines is well positioned to satisfy. The pair decided that a full-bodied, flavorsome stout-style beer would work best to counteract the loss of taste sensation frequently experienced by astronauts in zero gravity. They even hired a professional space tester to try the beer during a zero-gravity flight over Florida while recording basic biometric data to track effects of the experiment. Jason Held says the science is important.
Your face puffs out a little bit, your tongue swells up a little bit. It's not extreme, but it's kind of like having a bad head cold. So we wanted to have a flavor that could be strong enough that punched through that. And the other side is carbonation, because in the beer, the bubbles in the liquid, they don't separate very well in zero gravity. So it's kind of a problem in space drinking any type of a carbonated beverage. When you drink it, the gas doesn't have anywhere to go. So if you want to burp, it's going to be called a wick, where the gas and the liquid come out together. It's rather uncomfortable.
But Hell says Four Pines is on the right track, with additional experiments planned to establish the effects of alcohol absorption on the human body in zero gravity.
We know in high altitude flying, like if you go on an aircraft, you know that the body does not metabolize alcohol as quickly as it does here on Earth. So you've actually had a couple of cases of alcohol poisoning where people get on an aircraft, they drink a lot of beer, and they're enjoying themselves, and they don't feel like they're drunk. And the moment they get back on the ground, all that alcohol flushes through your system, and you get drunk very, very quickly. And we want to see if there are similar effects with microgravity that we haven't learned before.
And then there's the all-important issue of the glass. How to persuade the beer to resist zero gravity and flow the way it does on Earth. For the pair, it's another challenge to be met and overcome. They're confident that within 2 years, space tourism will be viable business, and that Four Pines Stout will take travelers to even greater heights.
This next one's a little bit repetitive, but I had to include it. It's about the same brewery, but the newsiness and the anchormanness of it is even better.
Brisbane scientists have made a major breakthrough for tourist space travel. They've proven it is possible to BYO beer.
Space, the final frontier for beer. It's been challenging mankind since we were first blasted off. Can humans drink beer in space? Finding out means dropping some from a great height, 21 metres, to create zero gravity.
We're trying to work out the various recipes of the beer so that we look at carbonation,
many bubbles, and the astronauts won't keep their beer down.
Well, the brewery is trying to get the carbonation level correct so that when it's consumed in reduced gravity, it stays where it belongs and does not reappear.
Four Pines Space Brewery from Sydney and NASA are behind the tests.
They have reduced the carbonation level significantly.
We'll skip ahead at this point. Once the results are in. The Aussies are the first ones to bring beer into space, as we'll learn.
Back from orbit and ready to market, space beer is splashing down on selected breweries in Japan this month. The result of a five-month mission to boldly grow where almost no one has grown barley before, the beverage had its extraterrestrial origins on the International Space Station. Courtesy of the Russian Academy of Science, a Japanese university, and beer giant Sapporo, the brewer unveiled its not-for-profit beer on Thursday in Tokyo. It will sell six-pack sets to the first 250 lucky beer lovers selected by lottery. Each box is priced at about $115 for the six 330-milliliter bottles, or a rather stratospheric $19 a bottle. Sapporo said all proceeds will go to a children's educational science charity in Japan and Russia, with no word on what might next be on the launch pad. Kirsty Bassett, Reuters.
Just because it's so terrible.
I think this one's definitely proved that all of these are really just marketing exercises and not in any way scientific. Has that better been? And dropping it everywhere in slow motion.
Well, I quite like how they have to actually reverse a lot of the shots for him to actually get anything in any of the glasses.
Well, wonderful.
It's also the thing that, you know, all of these exercises, it's the kind of classic marketing thing of, can we blow it up? Can we make it bigger than anyone else, faster than anyone? Can we send it to space? And booze companies normally have slightly more money than everyone else, so they get to send things to space.
To finish off the kind of commercial section, I guess, before we skip ahead, we kind of put our heads together and we thought, you know, what is going to be the sort of first, you know, what are people going to want to drink when they get back from riding with this chap? I don't know how he managed to get out of that window, actually. It's so small. He's like, his torso is bigger than the window. Exactly, a spaceship, exactly. So we asked Sam, being the expert on food and beverage, and champagne was the obvious choice, and it comes with a great demo. So what are the challenges going to be facing? I mean, is champagne and space impossible? What's your research?
I think one of the things that when people like to celebrate, they love to celebrate with champagne. It's universal, it's so bloody expensive that everyone knows you've done something awesome. And it comes with rituals all of a sudden. It's got that wondrous sparkle. It also comes with a lot of problems. You've heard about the wet burps, disgusting. But also, in every bottle of champagne, there are about 250 million bubbles. It's under a lot of pressure. If you pop a cork on this in your spaceship, it's going to be a mess. So I'll just demonstrate that for you, but also teach you something as well, hopefully. So that if you haven't learned about space at the end of this, you've certainly learned how to knock the top off a champagne bottle successfully. So there's some practical stuff you can do at home. So basically, just to demonstrate the amount of champagne, I'm just going to chop the top of this bottle.
And I've got a champagne save for this, which, interestingly, they let me take to France last time I was going on the Eurostar. They're like, that's okay. it's quite civilized. I might just go sort of off mic here.
But I can shout though, so hopefully you can all hear. When you're doing sobriety, if you take your champagne bottle and you look around, it's very low light, you should see a line down it. That's the mold line, and that's the weak point you want to exploit. If you hit it properly, you don't even need to do it with anything like this or even a heavy kitchen knife. You can do it with just a stem of wine glass. I'm not that good though. So if you find that line, which is there, and what you aim to do is run your heavy knife right the way down the bottle along the line. I can still see it. And catch just the neck of the bottle.
You seem to be in the safest place, directly behind you.
So, there you are. So, catch the neck of the bottle there. The important thing is to follow through. So, let's see what 250 million bottles of carbon dioxide does. Not like that. Okay, I like to normally warm it up a little bit. So you obviously don't want that happening on board your spacecraft. So what we're advocating instead, perhaps for a future of drinking, is if you're very canny, and this goes back to our wobbly heart, you can get all those bubbles in a lovely champagne gel matrix so you can't escape. So we've got a lovely jelly coming around here. Again, this is one where there should be a number of spoons arrayed around it. Take a spoon, have a bite, see if you can detect some carbon dioxide in it. So that'll be a little prickle against your tongue. Don't double dip, so only use your spoon once. And pass it on to everyone else. And keep your spoon so it doesn't get all mixed up and weird.
I should point out this man is not Arnold Schwarzenegger. He was just in Sam's original presentation, and I couldn't resist leaving him in there. It's just nothing to do with space at all, but yeah. He's a happy man.
He's Arnold Schwarzenegger's familiar.
That bottle's actually a normal size. It's really small.
Tiny hand. This is our backup in case it didn't work. We're going to show you a picture of Sam doing it previously. At a previous soiree. Cheers, everybody.
Cheers.
We have enough. Okay, we were where the bottle was going to break.
We don't get any jelly.
Yeah,
that's true.
Okay, so for our next section, we're going to look a little bit into the far and distant future beyond, and kind of imagine where alcohol in space might go next. We already have a pretty good idea, because on the space station and other spacecraft, they've been quite bored and experimenting with different ways of consuming liquids, which may point to future champagne flutes, future pint glasses, future sherry snifters, and so on. So here's a little video. Again, the way the guy talks is really weird, but he explains what they've come up with for drinking in space. This is the state of the art. This is today's research.
And we can coffee out from a bag, but to drink it from a cup is hard to do because you can't pick the cup up and get the liquid out, and it's also easy to slosh. So with the special shape of this cup, the surface tension forces will wick the coffee up along the edge there, and as you can see as I'm putting some coffee there in the bag. And the way this works is the cross-section of this cup looks like an airplane wing, and the sharp angle, the narrow angle there will whip the coffee up, and this is what what we use when we design fuel tanks for rockets to reignite in a weightless environment the vanes in the tanks will wick the fluid into the suction port. And if that angle is less than 2 times 90 minus the contact weighting angle, then the liquid will rise like that. So knowing this for a fuel tank, you can make it into a cup to drink your fluid from. So you can just sit there right on the edge of the cup, and as you sit, more fluid just keeps coming up and up and up, and you can enjoy a cup of coffee in a weightless environment without having to sip it from a bag. And you can just keep sipping and sipping and sipping, clear down to the last drop in the cup.
So,
and this may very well be what future space colonists end up using when they want to have a celebration and do a toast, and they can sip their coffee and their tea from cups like this, like we do down here on Earth, without having to suck them from a bag.
It basically says cup and bag 17 more times, so we'll
stop. One of the good things, he is very excited about that, but it does mean he actually, for the first time, gets to nose his cup of coffee. He gets to use his nose in his cup of coffee and not just have to sip it like this, which of course means you get all of the orthonasal flavor sort of perception rather than just the retronasal flavor perception, which means when you swallow something, you breathe it out and it comes back through your nose that way. Like orthonasal's a bit nicer.
Yeah. So we were all talking the other day about sort of, you know, other ways that liquid could be consumed in space travel as more and more people go into space. Gelatin and turning things into jelly was one. We discussed intravenous. We thought that was potentially a bit dangerous for us. Breathing vapors, and actually Sam has really created the walk-in gin and tonic, which was a vapor thing. That would also involve probably the whole spacecraft becoming alcoholic, which could also be a little bit dangerous.
Although we should point out that the Russians actually made a sauna on Mir, so there is form for this already. There is technology exists to have a sort of isolated part of the capsule where you can fill it. Yeah, absolutely. Did anyone get to taste, or how do you say, breathe in Bompas and Parr's cocktails, 1, 2, 3 people. Can you explain a little bit how it worked and like what the kind of physiology behind it?
Yes, it's pretty simple actually. Basically what we did is we took gin and tonic and we're a little bit worried because basically you're inhaling it, becoming intoxicated through your lungs and eyeballs. But we worked with some guys who were some respiratory scientists, they consult for NASA, and they were almost like our mixologists, and they worked out that a ratio of one part gin to 3 parts tonic in the size of space it was, people's average lung capacity, the volume of their rate of breathing, the rate of absorption, and back of an envelope, they said, look, we can't really say this very efficiently, but probably with all these different factors, they will have the equivalent of one large gin and tonic in 40 minutes. So at that point, we were able to present all these calculations to Westminster, and they were very happy that there was going to be responsible drinking. The only other thing is we're selling other large gin and tonics for £2.50 a pop. Yes, there were a number of different effects all happening at the same time. One of the interesting things, though, is that as you start spatializing flavor like that to make it the atmosphere, because it becomes very, very humid, that humidity increases your flavor perception. So if you think about when you go on an airline, which is a very dry environment, or apparently if you're in the Antarctic, or indeed in space as well, they're all very, very dry environments, that decrease in humidity means that you can't pick up as much flavor at all. By contrast, if you go and see it sit at the seaside, and this is why people often buy very bad wine, in areas where there's high humidity, you sit there and you go, golly, this wine's incredible, this is really great, I'm getting all sorts of different notes and flavours in it, and you get it home to London, and even though we're relatively humid at the moment, with all the rain, it's not quite the same as sitting by the sea, and so it then tastes pretty disgusting, like a bad wine.
That
That could explain the phenomena of buying booze on holiday and it yes. being amazing.
Yeah, and that's it.
You know, Uzo is a good example. Yeah. Try that in England.
So, oh, sorry.
And you've also done some research in the past about even further out into space, even further out into the future, if we're talking in terms of light year travel, getting far beyond Earth's orbit, far beyond the moon, far beyond the asteroids and Mars even. And out there, there's some pretty amazing stuff.
Absolutely. So out in the far reaches of space, well, actually in this Milky Way, there have been discovered by radio wave detection vast clouds of interstellar alcohol, which is rather exciting. The only problem is that it's about 26,000 light years away, so it's going to be bloody hard to get there. But we thought for your taster for this, it would be only appropriate. So there's things like ethanol. You've already had enough ethanol. There's methanol, and we definitely don't want to give you any methanol, because, you know, going away with all the tips is okay, going away blind, definitely bad. But there's also diethyl ether as well, which is a close sister of ethanol and alcohol, and we've got some here. Basically, you might know it because it's the stuff in Fearing Glow Las Vegas, they soak a rag and put it on the floor of the car. It has an effect very, very similar to alcohol, but actually wears off after just 20 minutes. And although you do have an incredibly bad hangover. So we'll pass some of this round.
Alcohol doesn't normally have these symbols.
Well, it actually would. It's got a flame symbol and an alarm symbol. It's incredibly flammable, so if there's a flame symbol over there, this could light. So don't have any naked flames, please. And also because you don't normally get 100% proof ethanol, in which case it would have that. But what I'm going to do is I'll soak this rag with it, and you can sort of waft it towards yourself. Don't suck on the rag, and you'll be okay. Okay? Please don't suck on the rag. Right, just don't suck on the rag. It's one of these things that it'll be quite familiar to you. It's actually still the most widely used general anaesthetic in the world.
It's still the most widely used anaesthetic in the world. So you'll recognise it as a sort of bit of a hospital-y smell, and that's because it's got one of the highest therapeutic indexes of any general anaesthetic. The therapeutic index is the difference between when it has an effect and, you know, worse than anaesthetic, and when you die. So that's a really good thing, because there's a massive operating area in between those two. So if you, we'll pass a few of these ether-soaked rags around. And you can imagine what is out there for us to discover light years away. The wonders of space.
So the cloud of alcohol that exists in space is huge, isn't it, Chris? I don't know if you have a figure of the actual size of the cloud of alcohol.
Did you start on the right? It's 26,000 light years.
So it's 26,000 light years away. Okay. But for some reason I have in my head it's 288 light years wide. That might be the reason. But...
Yeah,
that's
right.
Yeah. So when we were discussing this cloud of alcohol in space and the future of drinking in space, we thought, actually, rather than taking alcohol space, and you've sort of heard, well, that's potentially dangerous, if there was a way to sort of distill alcohol in space, that could be quite a good option for future civilizations.
Absolutely, yeah. If we had even half an hour longer, we would now be showing you a visually spectacular mock-up with a Guinness brewery floating in space. Photoshop versus time matrix just ran out. But basically the idea was to take these giant clouds of alcohol, simulated here in jelly by Bompas and Parr, And basically hook them up to this thing, which is a theoretical device used by Type 3 civilizations. These are civilizations that are much more advanced than us, find a way to harness the power of an entire star. So this is a Dyson sphere under construction. It's starting to be ringed by various devices for trapping sunlight. Eventually, it's theorized these things would cover entire suns, and we could sort of detect alien civilizations by looking specifically for these structures. So yeah, if we had
as a star faded, you'd know.
Absolutely, you know that something's being built around it. You'd be able to detect the signature of these things. So far, we haven't found one yet, but they may be out there, and who knows, they may be hooked up to giant distilleries, mining massive amounts of alcohol, and somewhere there's like some kind of intergalactic Bompas and Parr featured in some sort of intergalactic Gourmand magazine. They're doing this very thing at the moment. But the grand finale, in terms of this presentation, and in terms of what you've been drinking, now that you're all nicely ethered up, is the future taste of space. Where is the magical golden orb?
I think it's been broken down into individual.
Here we are. So this is, do you want to introduce it?
Yeah, sure thing.
Okay, so as astronauts come back from moonwalks, they have been known to sniff their spacesuit. I'm not sure why they do this, but a lot of them have a very similar experience when they've started sniffing the suit. And what they recall is the smell of space that they've picked up on the exterior, the whiffs of it drawn into the cabin, is a mixture of rum, raspberries, and something a little bit metallic as well. So this hasn't been very scientifically made, it's purely speculative. And for it, we have a powerful rum, a maceration of raspberries, and some 24-karat gold as well, a little gold muster. So don't worry, the gold is totally inert. Will do nothing within your body, it will pass straight through you and out the other side. But it just gives you that little metallic twang as you drink it down. So this is your taste of space, an imagining, an interpretation of what it could taste like. I actually see that the tastes of space are actually rather large. I was thinking that they'd be about half that size when I made them up today. So beware.
Can we ask prosaically what is in the taste of space, or is this a trade secret?
Rum macerated.
Just to say again, within the taste of space, it's all the flavours that have been reported by the astronauts, which is rum, macerated raspberries, and metallic twang provided by the gold leaf, 24-karat gold.
Yeah,
and that's it.
We found a rather special clip to finish things off. This is a little bit, you know, you're all over 18. You've all, you know, been drinking all afternoon, so hopefully you're all over 18. A little bit blue to kind of finish things off. And yeah, I guess join me please in thanking Sam from Bompas and Parr, Dave from Gourmand, and the Archetypalist for having us in this beautiful, amazing building as part of this amazing exhibition, which is open for another couple of minutes yet, once we have this little toast.
Minutes. Can I just say, Chris, you've got 15 minutes to see the exhibition and also visit the Moon Rock Pop Shop. I get it always
going. Yeah, me too. So, yeah.
Visit our beach. Everything must go, isn't it, Chris?
It is, yeah. Discounts on many items in the shop. Not all. In fact, not even many. Some. Discounts on some items, and some things must go.
To take your drinks with you around the exhibition.
Absolutely. And finish off anything that's not been drunk yet. Yeah, but yeah, that's really the toast. Thanks guys for coming down. And here is a new